Alright, so welcome back to our next lesson. So tonight, I'm going to go over this real quickly, what we're going to be going over. So we're going to be going over the tri-catch, which I use religiously. We're going to go over what it is and how to use it. We're going to go over error logging, or exception handling, basically, or catching exceptions. We're going to go over creating a DLL and then referencing that DLL in a project. Or at least we're going to try. I'm going to briefly mention referencing. I don't think we're actually going to get to the part where you actually take our DLL and actually create a separate project to reference in it. I think what we're going to do is just simply start working on our save and load DLL for capturing error logging and stuff. And we're going to talk about commenting. We're going to maybe plan out a basic design document. And then we're gonna create a general class. So we're not gonna be doing what's seemingly a whole lot, but actually we're gonna be doing stuff that's gonna be like really important. You know, it's gonna be very useful. You know what I mean? So let's go ahead and start with So let's go ahead and open up Visual Studio. And we'll go ahead and start with our simple math app. And we're going to get away from this. By the end of tonight, we're going to start a new project. And we won't be using this one anymore. Just let me know when you get it up. Is it coming up? Just let me know when you're ready. Alright, so what I want us to do now is just go ahead and create a new project. So we're just going to go File New. And we're going to do a Windows Form application. Actually, you know what? No, we're going to do a class library, I'm sorry. We're going to do a class library this time, I'm sorry. For Visual C Sharp. Let me know when you get there, and I'll tell you the name. We're just going to call it general functions, underscore functions. Actually, let's just go with general. We'll just stick with the word general. Meaning that this is going to be like our general, stuff. So your namespace will be general, and it'll come to class form. And then, let me know when you get there. We're going to rename this. still loading? Okay, I was waiting on you. Okay. So, come over to your Solution Explorer on the right-hand side, or wherever it may be, in the view, whatever. Mine's docked over here. But you're just going to right-click, rename. And let's call this class just, functions. Or actually, let's call it save underscore load. Yeah, we'll go with that. Save underscore load. Or we can go save dash load. I like the underscore there. Let's stick with the underscore. So save and load. And what we're going to rename it. Does yours look like that? Okay. So this is going to be like our save and load function. But before we do that, let's flip back. So first thing we want to talk about today is, what is a try-catch? So a try-catch simply tries to execute your block of code, and then if an exception occurs, it catches the exception and allows you to do further handling of the exception, to do something else or to try to do something else, perform a different action basically. So the question is, how is this useful? Well, if our application fails, instead of just crashing or, you know, that particular sub-procedure failing, we can handle that exception and return something else, you know, like a null value or something, indicating that, you know, there was a failure. Maybe even just, like, pop up a pop-up message. Which brings us to error logging. So, it's how you handle an exception or an error. What is an error? So, let's make an error. Actually, you can't do that. Just write a class. So, what we can do is, let's minimize that. Open up another instance of Visual Studio. And come back to our Simple Math app real quick. We can actually see an error. Let's take a look at our form here, see if we have like a clicky button here or something we can work with. Let's go to form 1 on our design. Just go into the click event. And what I want to do here is I just want to comment out all this. Or you can remove it, it doesn't matter because we're not going to use this anymore. Just let me know when you get there. And what I'm going to do while I'm waiting on you, Matt, is I'm going to go ahead and type out the error code, the code that's going to generate an error. And then I'll explain it when you get done. Okay, so go ahead and go to your Form 1 design, the design view for Form 1, and then go in to the click event for the submit button, and then I commented out all of this code, and then I'm going to add this try catch. And then I'm going to go ahead and type in what we're going to generate to actually get this to throw an exception. explain this in just a second. Let me know when you get there. Are you close enough for me to start talking, or are you still typing? Okay. Alright, so what we've done here is we've created this variable called str, or string for short. So we have this string value that's AAA, and then we have... Welcome back, Matt. Alright, so to recap here, so we have the string variable that we've set the default value to AAA, and then we have this integer variable called val, and that we're converting the string to an integer. Now, the reason why we're doing this is to show you what an exception is, or an error. This is going to throw an error because AAA is not a numeric value. So clearly this is going to throw an exception when we click on this button. So let's go ahead. Did you get all this? Okay, so let's go ahead and debug. This would be the last time that we use this math app. Mine will probably take just a second to debug. Alright. Let me know when your application's up. Yours might take a little bit longer than mine to debug. And then be sure to set your breakpoint as well, like right after the try. That way we can step through the code. Okay, so go ahead and just click on your submit button, and it should hit your breakpoint. Okay, yep, I want my breakpoint, let me know when you get there. Okay, so we're going to press the F10 key to step through. So we're at our first line, and then this line right here is going to error. Okay, so we're going to go to our, we're going to catch the exception. So F10, exception, F10 one more time. Now, we knew that we threw an exception, and we want to know what the exception is. So we can hover over what this says. We know when you get there. Now, sometimes this is going to be a good description of the error, and sometimes it'll be a bad one. So this could be possibly confusing. Input string was not a current or in a current correct format. So that kind of makes sense. What it's saying is that the input value or input string value was not an integer based value or numeric based value. So that's why we threw an exception, which we were anticipating that. Does that make sense? Okay, we can stop debugging this. So now we understand what an exception is. Go ahead and close this out. Blow that out. And we can reopen the other one. Alright, and then I'm going to take a pause for the cause because I think my wife is cooking, so I'll be back in like 20 minutes. All right, Matt. Welcome back. Sorry, took a break. All right, so I switched things up a little bit while you were gone. I thought about it, and I looked at an old... well, I shouldn't say old. I looked at a DLL that I'm making currently for myself. So I thought, you know what? Instead of rewriting the same code over and over again, it might be easier actually just to go out and find existing code that I know that works instead of like trying to Google. So here's what I came up with. And I'll go ahead and explain this code. And I'll go ahead and walk you through it. So the first thing you want to do is create a new class. So go up here, you know, to add new item. And then just create a new class and call it save, as I did for mine. See how I have this save class? And then when you get it, initially it's not going to be a public class, so you want to make sure it's public. Okay? So it should just look like this, okay? Like, just focus on getting this far and let me know when you get there. And then you want to put in a stream writer. That's going to be a global to this class. But only used within this class, so to make it a private variable. And then while you're typing all of this, how far are you, by the way? Oh, all right. I'll let you at least get to the point where you have the class set to public and the StreamWriter variable. And then I'll start explaining the function. So go ahead and get that all typed in. So go up here to View, Solution Explorer, and then right click, Add New Item. See it? You see where I'm at? Okay. Yeah, the toolbox is for controls. Unfortunately, we won't be making any controls. Or at least not this time around. What we're doing with this, just so you know, we're going to create this DL. This is going to be a DLL that we're going to create. It was basically what we're going to convert this into. And then we're going to use this DLL for any project going forward. This is going to be where we save our data and load our data. For all of our future projects. So we're going to be using this class, well actually this project quite a bit. Or solution, yeah, well we'll go with project. We'll just say project for now. We'll just say we're going to use this project. Did you find it? Share. Okay, click on where it says Windows Form Application 2. Right click, add. You're in a form application, by the way, too. This is not going to work. You need to be in a class, so exit out of this, because we're not doing a form application anymore. So let's start from scratch. So exit out, click on exit, file exit. Yeah. File exit, like completely exit Visual Studio. And you are still debugging, that's another problem. So load up just a fresh instance of Visual Studio. And whatever that SIDWiz is that your application? Okay, never mind. Okay, so click on New Project. Okay, so class library selected down here for your solution name. You can't be getting click happy. You've now literally have a project called Class Library 1. Cancel that. Say file new project. Now, down here where it says solution name, or up there is fine. Click general and click OK. Cancel that and just call it common. Just call it common. There's two rooms. There you go. Okay. Now add your new class. Yeah. Right click. Add. New item. And it's already selected class for you, so come down here and change the class name to save. And click add. Okay, now right now your class is private, so go and make it public. Do you remember how? So look where it says class. And then change and add the word keyword public. Okay. Go ahead and stop sharing now, and I'll go ahead and start sharing. Okay. Now add this, your stream writer. So type with inside your class. Type private stream writer and then call it writer equal null. And it's probably going to give you an error. Let me know when you get that line typed in and it gives you the error. Okay, so what you need to do is you need to tell it up here in the top when you're importing. Tell it using system.io. Okay, that's for the stream writer. Alright, so next, go ahead and just copy my function. Just go ahead and copy this function word for word, and I'll go ahead and explain. I'll give you a few minutes to type in all that code. No, we were talking about try-catch before. As you see, there's an additional section in there called find me, and I'll go over that as soon as you get some of this code typed in. And you are going to get another error on the XML serializer. So once you get all this code typed in, I'll tell you what you need to import as well, or reference rather, I should say. just let me know when you're close or you're finished. Just for future reference, next time when you start to get behind like that, when things aren't working, just stop me, and then I can review it with you and take a look at it and see what you did wrong. Yeah, it's not going to, because we didn't, okay. Before you go any further, type in this line right up here, where it says, using system.xml serialization. That way the error will go away, and your IntelliSense will allow you to kick in. Did that work? Okay. Yeah, generally anytime you're doing any type of serialization, you're going to have to import a reference, or you're going to have to reference something. Probably something related to the system. And just out of curiosity or boredom, rather, while you do that, I'm going to type... I'm curious to see what all system has. I never actually looked. I have used almost all of these at some point. Getting close. Okay. Alright, so let me explain what we're doing here first, starting with this line on line 13. So the reason why the stream writer is not down here in this block of code is because this is specifically saving XML. What happens when you want to save to plain text, you know, or something else, you know, some other format? So that's why I have the stream writer up here, because eventually we'll add to this save class and we'll save it, our objects, or our data rather, in different types, you know, of file formats. Does that make sense? Okay. So that's future thinking. So that's one piece. The next thing is, we made this public. We made this a public function because obviously this is just a class. So there's no functionality that can really take place here as far as like the application. So this class that we built is going to be attached to an application because there's no Windows form in here or control or anything. So obviously this can't, you know, it's going to be dependent on an application. So that's why this is public, because we're going to be calling this function from another application in the future. And then the next piece is we have this object. Now, the reason why I picked object is because we're passing in a class. We're going to be passing in a class. So basically, we're going to be passing in a collection of properties. Remember when we built that one class that was just nothing but a bunch of properties? That's basically what we'll be passing in. So we'll be passing in that entire class, and here with the file name. And then if we look at what we're doing here, we're creating this XML serializer, and it's saying, give me this this object. I want to get the type of this I class. And then the next thing I want to do is I want to start the stream writer. The writer is going to equal the file name. And then at the very end of this process, I'm going to serialize the location or the file name, and I'm going to serialize this class. So basically, I'm just going to be saving the data. This is where it actually saves the data. Right here, we're setting up our data to go into our serializer and actually begin the process. So the stream writer right here is saying, here's my file location or my file name. And then this is saying, okay, I'm going to serialize this data. So here's where, you know, the stream writer goes, you know, like this is where the location or the name, and then here's where the actual data is that's coming in. So that's going to be our try statement. So we're going to try to do this block of code, okay? And then if we throw an exception, we're going to catch it. Okay? And then finally, we want to stop our stream writer, or we want to close our stream writer. So that's what we're doing on this line. So we're closing the stream writer because right now it's open, because right here we created this new stream writer and we opened it and started writing our data to this file location. So now we're closing it, we're stopping it, and then we want to set it back to null so we can use it again somewhere else. Does that make sense? Okay, I know that was like overly drawn out, overly explained. I get it, but it's important that we understand this process. We're opening up a file, we're writing data to the file, and then we're closing the file. We're passing in the file, the data that we're writing to the file is based on this class data that we're passing in. Now, that's writing the data or saving the data. The next thing that we need to do is we need to add this load class, which I have an error because I didn't import my serialization, which I just fixed that. So, next, you want to go to your Solution Explorer and add another new item. You're going to call this load. Okay? Let me know when you get there. Okay, so you want to make that a public class as well. And then you also want to add this. So you want it to load in the I class. And obviously you're going to need System.io again, and you're going to need XML serialization. So if you don't have that, you might as well go ahead and add that, because you're going to need to reference those. Now, that being said, these are built in. This is a built-in class. You know, the system class is built into Visual Studio, so we don't have to add any references because it's already built in. What we're building, this class that we're building right now, for applications that we use this class in, we're going to actually have to reference this. And we'll talk about that later, and you'll see what that actually means. So I wanted to bring that up real quickly since we're already referencing data. We're actually building our own class that we're going to be using as a reference to. Alright, so did you get this far? Okay. So, next thing right here is this public load. So this is called a constructor. So what this is saying is when you build this instance of this class, we're setting this variable type, which is type, we're setting that equal to the I class, the type of I class. So our type equals the I class. Okay, so it's kind of similar to how our object equals, you know, I class. Kind of a similar concept. Does that make sense? So, and then here's our actual function. Once again, we're using the try-catch finally. So, we're going to return this I class, which is this, basically, or virtually. That's what our return value is. So basically, we're returning an object or a class. And what you're passing in is the file name or the file path. Okay? So in our try, we have this I class is the XML data. Okay? So we're just saying that this is the XML data. The I class, this object is the XML data. Then here's our serializer that we need. And we're saying that we want to serialize this type, which if we look at what type is the I class. So we want to serialize the type. And then we have our file stream. A little bit different than a stream writer. Instead of saving data, this grabs data, captures the data. So the arguments for it is it wants to know, I believe it wants to know the location, which in our case is file name, the mode, the file mode, which is open, the access, which is read, and we need to share. And if you really want to know what these things mean, just hover over it, and IntelliSense will tell you exactly, if you look, what this means. I'm not going to go over it because I'm pretty sure we all know how to read. So finally, we're telling it that the XML data is going to be equal to this file stream. In a nutshell, that's basically what we're saying. So we're deserializing, because at this point right here, this is serialized in XML. Okay? So now we need to deserialize the XML into a raw format. Okay? And then we're going to return that raw format. In the event that you throw an error, we want to return this default I class, which is basically just a blank copy of the I class that you passed in, or a blank copy of the object that you passed in. So that way it doesn't throw an error, you know, on the other side. If that makes sense. Because if you try to return null, then you can't have a class that's just normal. So it'll throw an error. So it starts this trickle effect. So we're just going to tell it to return a default class that's just empty values or null values for the actual class. So if you have a bunch of properties within your class, all your property values are going to be null. Instead of just one giant null value, you know, all your property values are going to be null. It makes sense, like, when you actually use it, you'll see. As we use it later, you'll actually see it in practice, and it'll start to make more sense. Right now, just kind of keep that in the back of your mind. And then finally, we need to close out our file stream. Just like we did with our stream writer, you have to tell it to close the writer. In this case, the reader. Because this is reading data and not writing data. So we gotta tell it to stop. So that's the difference between saving and loading. So now that we actually have that, we're actually in a pretty good place. However, remember, this one is just for loading XML data. That's the only thing that this supports, is loading XML data. It does not support, like, loading Microsoft Word, Microsoft Excel, PowerPoint, stuff like that. It only supports XML. So that's why we have this load class. So if we want different types of file formats in the future, we can support that in the future. Because we've set that up. Okay? So go ahead and save all if you haven't already. See where we're at on stuff. Alright, let's come back to this. We kind of did some of this and we'll come down here. So, we talked about we're creating a DLL. So, let's go to Google. DLL stands for Dynamic Link Library, but let's actually go grab the actual definition of DLL. I didn't spell definition right. Alright, short for Dynamic Link Library, a library of executable functions or data that can be used by a Windows application. Typically, a DLL provides one or more particular functions and programs, accesses the functions by creating either a static or dynamic link to the DLL. Okay, that's a little confusing, so fire away with your questions now. If you don't have any, it's fine. It's fine. So, here's an advantage of DLL, and we'll come back to that, your questions in a second. So, an advantage to a DLL, it's supposed to be read-only. Okay, that's number one. So, meaning that you can't write data to this, and you can't modify it. That's an advantage to a DLL. Supposedly it's read-only, but there are tools where you can open up a DLL and you can get the code. But typically that's supposed to be an advantage. So it mentioned reference. So if we come in here into Solution Explorer, let's come on into Solution Explorer. Let me know when you're there. Alright, remember we talked about how this is a project, right? Okay. We can have multiple projects in a single solution. So what we're going to do now is we're going to create another project just so we can see how to reference this DLL, okay? So, what we want to do, you want to come up to File. Actually, let's do this the easier way. In Solution Explorer, just right click, and I believe it's just Add New Project. Let me see. Okay. should just be add project. For some reason, sometimes it may or may not give it to you. Let me try building this and maybe clean this out. Try building it. There should be an option to add a new project. Are you getting that? Try to file new project. That works. Alright, so go up to your file and just click on new project. It should be over here, but it's not. So this time we're going to do a Windows Form application. And then, let's see, what kind of project do we want to do? Let's pick a Windows form called Person. So, did you get to this part? Okay, go ahead and create your Person project. Give it a second. Let me know when you get to this part. Okay, click Save All. It's going to pop up this and just click Save. That way we know that it's there. And then, when you get that far, let me know. And then go into your Solution Explorer again. I wonder if it, no. Hold on. For some reason, it doesn't have. It didn't put our general and our person project in there together in the same solution. It was supposed to combine them. I might have to go Google that real quick to see why it did that. Because we need to do that, because it makes debugging a lot easier. Let me go check on that real quick. Alright, so this is suggesting go to Tools, then select Option, and then click Projects and Solutions tab, and on the right side, and click the Always Show Solution. Okay, let's try that. So let's go to Tools. I think it was Options. And click Projects. Solutions. Did you find that? Okay, so go to Tools, Options, and then scroll down where you see Projects and Solutions. And then do you see where it says Always Show Solution? Check that, and click OK. Mine wasn't. So go into your projects folder and find that person solution that's separate and then just delete it. If you didn't say, if it's in there, I don't know if yours has it or not. Mine has it because, you know, I created this. The person project. Just let me know when it's gone, because we're gonna recreate. We're gonna recreate it in here. So go to your Solution Explorer, in your general, or in your case, common, in your common class. And then on Solution Explorer, right click, and see where it says new project. Do you have that? Do you need me to look at it with you? Okay, add new project. We're gonna select the Windows Form application and we're gonna call it Person. Okay? See what I'm doing? And then when we come back to our Solution Explorer, we should see both our general, or in your case, the common, and we should see our person project. So we have two separate projects, but they're both visible. Are you at that point? Okay, great. Now, what you want to do is click on Save All. So it saves everything, okay? Now, go up here to your build, click clean solution, okay? Now it's gonna delete everything, okay? That's for debugging purposes, it's gonna delete everything, okay? And then click rebuild solution, okay? Now, go into your Windows Explorer and find your project. It should be in your My Computer Documents, Visual Studio 2015 Projects, and it should be under General, or in your case, Common. Okay? And then when you get to this part, let me know. You should see your General and your Person. Okay. Now, this is our General, or your case, Common project. If you go in there, you'll see this bin folder, okay? When we're clicking on clean, this is what we're removing, is all this stuff in here, okay? We're removing all that and we're rebuilding it, okay? So if you go into the debug portion, you know, keep digging into it, you'll find this general DLL. Do you see that? Or, yeah, your case, common.dll. Did you rebuild? Are you in the debug folder? So go to your build, rebuild. Let me see you. Go ahead and share. Okay, go back to common. Okay, and minimize. Click on build. Click on rebuild solution. You got errors, that's why. So you got 15 errors. I'm assuming you didn't import system IO, or yeah, you got that. Okay, so you are so you're missing some code here at some point. Okay. You've got to have all of it. So let me go back to my code. In your try catch here, that's why. So let me go ahead and stop sharing and I'll start sharing. So you're on the load, right? Okay. I'll be right back. Go ahead and start typing this in. Do you have all the save or and you're just missing load or? I'll leave my load screen up and I'll be right back with my wife yelled at me for something. So I'll be right back and I'll let you type that all in, okay? Make sure it's line for line, okay? How we doing? Okay. I have no idea what my wife wanted. She was just like, we need to talk. And I was like, about what? She was like, stuff. I was like, okay, what stuff? And then it was like silence. So, I don't understand girls. I'm married, but I still don't understand. I was like, did I do something wrong? No. Okay, well, I'll be back. Let me know when you figure out, though, you know, what I did wrong. So, you know. I'll be sure not to do that again, whatever it was, you know, what I did, whatever. about two glasses into the evening, so I'm pretty sure it'll be an interesting whatever I get wrong. How's it looking? Okay. You don't have errors this time, do you? Did you create your constructor? Did you import your system I/O and, or reference, I mean, your system I/O and your XML serialization? And did you give it a default? Like, you set the public, you gave it a return to default? Look at my screen. You have that? In your catch, yeah, that's why you're throwing an error. Over line for line. Any better? Did you return this in your catch? And you have this set to this, your I class equals XML data, and you have a this argument? And you have your catch wrapped? You're finally wrapped. All your code looks exactly like mine. Okay. Still errors? Sure. Scroll up. You need to scroll up more. I think I know what you did wrong. You got a bracket and only. Yeah. Go to where it says private file stream. Click right there, right below it. Below it, one line. Go down one. No. Right there. No. Just press the arrow key down. Backspace. Scroll down to the bottom. keep going down. Go, go, go. No, no, no. No, 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 no. I didn't. Press enter. And hold shift. Yeah. Enter the backspace thingy. Yeah. There you go. Now scroll up. That should. Let's see here. Go all the way down. I want to count your closing brackets. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And you'll get my 4. 2, 3, 4. Okay. Get rid of that last one on the bottom. Backspace one more time. Scroll up. 1, 2, 3, 4. We at least got that right. Scroll up. Go down a little bit. Down a little bit more. Okay, press backspace once. Now put that back in there. Okay. Click on where it says CS 1513 in the error. You're missing a bracket somewhere to the right of that. Right there. No, 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 no. You need 4, but you have 1. Right there. Okay, I'm just gonna send you it though. I'm not gonna try to figure out where you're missing. Play all night missing the chasing down the missing bracket. Go ahead and stop streaming real quick, please. Let's copy and paste that. I'm not quite sure where you messed up on. Still got errors. Error free. Okay, click on your clean from the build. Clean your solution. And then rebuild it. Let me know when you get that far. Did it finish? Okay, go to Windows Explorer. Find your solution. Inside. So now you have your DLL. Okay. Good. Now we're going to go back to our persons project, which is the form application. Now, we need to add a reference. So click on your references. We're going to right click and say add reference, okay? And you have this screen that pops up. Let me know when you get there. Now, there's two ways to get to our DLL, okay? Because it's inside of our current solution, we can go this way. You click on projects, do you see it? Or we can browse to it. So click on browse. And browse to it. Let me know when you've got there. Now, the advantage of using this, the projects, is that anytime that you update it within the solution, it will automatically update when you rebuild or when you compile this will be updated automatically for you, okay? So that's the advantage of when you create a DLL, you know, in a separate solution or in a separate project within the solution. You don't have to consistently keep updating it when you make changes. When you do the browse function direction, so when you have to browse to your DLL, when you make changes to that DLL, you have to update the reference within the project itself, okay? So if we had this person's project and we had it separate in a different solution, but let's say we came in here and we added in the save and the load, we added an option for saving as a text document. We'd have to come in here and we'd have to update our reference if we wanted to use that functionality, okay? So for now, since we did it this way though, go ahead and click on projects and then just check where it says general and then click OK. Okay. And now we want to make an application that's just going to store information about people, okay? So let's go ahead and build the designer first. So we're going to need a label. And we're going to need some text boxes. So let's just get a label and a text box. So first thing we're going to do, and let me know when you got that far. The first thing we're going to do, I want to change this to say first name. Our first label. And it helps if you know how to spell first instead of fist. Change that to LBL first name. Let's stretch that out a little bit. And get a first name in there. Then I'm going to do a second name. Or last name I need, not second name. I'm just going to go ahead and keep on building this, and I'm sure you can keep up, or you can get it going at least at your own pace here. Now, I'll also point out in the real world, I would not be, for labels, I would probably not be adjusting the name. I would probably just leave it whatever the default was. But since we're new developers, or you are rather, I want to teach you good practices, or at least let you get practicing, you know, using the Hungarian notation. Later on it won't be that important, or at least not for labels, but it's, you still need to know about that text box. So I'll change up the text boxes later. Let's see. And I'm going to set the max length on my state to 2, because we're just going to use, initials. Just an FYI. And then for the zip code, I'm going to use a numeric drop down. That way it'll force numbers only. Actually, you know what, I'll just use a text box for that too. That way it all looks uniform. I can do a custom control, but we won't go into that. I'm gonna go back now. I'm gonna do my text boxes on the as far as the naming. Problems? I think you kind of see though how the labeling goes. Are you catching on to how the labeling goes for the naming convention? Okay. Yeah, are you waiting on me? Yeah, I'm listening. Like, how long is a little bit? Like, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 20 minutes? Okay. Yeah. So, do you have all this, and then you got your naming convention for your text boxes? And then you got your registration button. So now we're gonna create a new class real quickly. Because we gotta have a class to. We're gonna have all this information, we gotta have a class for it, okay? So we may not be able to finish tonight. So we're gonna, on our persons project, we're gonna create a new class. So click new item. We're going to call this class data. You got it? And this is literally just going to be, it's going to be a public class. And this is going to be, that's if you spell public, right? There we go. Oh yeah, C sharp's case sensitive, by the way. Alright, so we're gonna need a first name, last name, so we're gonna create strings. And I like to use underscore. Actually, I don't need to declare private because it's always private by default. Since it's, you know, a global variable, I like to use underscore to indicate that it's a global variable, and then inside of a sub procedure I don't use underscore, indicating that it's only good within that procedure. So that's a good practice. And then you always want to set your values to string.empty or a null value. And then for the sake of time, I'm going to copy and paste this about 1,000 times. And then all of these boxes right here that we have is the variables that we need. So first name, last name, so on and so forth. So go ahead and get that class built. Keep things simple, we'll have zip as a string as well. We'll just make all these variables a string, including phone numbers. Normally I would define them as like an integer, but for the sake of simplicity, we'll go ahead and go a different route. I hope I did that right. I'm gonna feel really stupid because I didn't. So now I'm gonna go Google just real quick. So sad. Okay. Wish it was Visual Basic, it'd be so much easier. Can't believe I forgot my the syntax. Hopefully you got it right on the first time, and yeah, I'm sure somebody out there will be laughing when they watch this. Like, oh, this dumbass can't even write a property. So go ahead and get all your properties set up. This concept will be very similar to how we cleared. When we start working with databases, it'll be a very similar concept to databases. And databases, I think, are a lot easier to work with, especially when you get into SQL. Because then you don't have to do any of this bullshit. Because then you're just saving it to a database. You don't have to save the flat files or anything. It's so much easier. So much more you can do with it too. How's your property class looking? So what I want to do here, as soon as you get this done, it'll be done in like just a few minutes. As soon as you get your property class set up, I want to show you how to reference the DLL that we made. But first we gotta make this property class. Or this data class, I should say. It's just basically our data. It's our properties for our data. So let me know when you get it finished. And then we'll be done in like 2 minutes. Sorry, this class kind of ran long, didn't it, a little bit. I usually just write the class or the property once, and then I just copy and paste it and go back and change the name variables. That makes it a lot faster than trying to write each property out. I don't know if that's what you did or not, but that's what I highly recommend. Because I don't think anybody else, like, actually writes the same thing, like, over and over again. Usually we're copy and pasters. I did. I'm stupid. I am dumb. Maybe I can fix this. I knew that something was wrong. I was like, man, how's that referencing itself? I'm just setting a value. My code's fixed. Does yours look like mine? So in your return, you have the underscore cell phone. Okay, because I didn't do that originally. Like, I totally did not do that correctly. Almost there. Okay. Got it? Okay. Alright, so now we need to go back into our form data and then right click, go into the view code. So you need to go into the code designer. Let me know when you get there. So first thing we need to do is we need to create a new instance of our data class. We're going to say data underscore data equals new data. I don't think we need brackets. Oh yeah, we do. So did you get that? This basically just creates a blank carbon copy of this class. And then the last thing that we need to do is we want to reference our general, or in your case, common. So we can start using those functions. So make sure that that's in there. You got it? So now I wanted to show you one more thing. So come up here to the register button and double click. Got it? So I'm going to type in general, and it should give me the load and the save command functions. In your case, common. I mean, we'll have to actually declare a new, we'll have to do a lot more than just that, but I wanted to show you that now you can actually access those functions. Does that make sense? Okay, let me double check, make sure that we went over everything, or at least tried. Well, we were going to actually save, we didn't go over project design, but we can go over that another time. And commenting it and stuff, we'll go over that later. But you got the general gist of what we're doing, right? Okay, so this is going to be our new project going forward. Alright, so that's pretty much all I got for this time, and we'll go over more later, okay? Alright, bye.